Yeah, last class we had done with the introduction to data mining, data warehousing. We had seen the various models, the architecture, all that we had seen. So I told you all, second module, I want you all to give a seminar. So I have prepared a brief how the seminar should go. I'll just share it sometime in between. So next week, all of you can start with your seminar. You can prepare your PPTs because your IA is on May, I've already put it up on the group. May 17th, 18th and 19th is your first IA internals. So your first internals, you will be having the first and the second module. So first module is completed. So I want you to finish the presentation on the second module so that we can include that for the IA. Okay, so parallelly, so you have time till next week, next Tuesday and Wednesday, you can finish your presentations. I think on Tuesday, one day only you can finish it. Otherwise we will extend to Wednesday, okay? So you can share it with the others also who are in the group, that I'll share this, the schedule. So based according to the schedule, you have to give your presentations. Now we will start with the third module. I hope the first module, is it clear to everyone? Any clarifications, doubts for the first module? Did you all go through the notes and the questions, what was shared earlier? Any clarifications were there?
Ma'am.
Okay, so no clarifications. I think all of you have understood that. Okay, now the next topic, that is the third module, it is a very important chapter because a lot of problems and all this. In case I'm not audible anytime, please tell me, okay? So a lot of problems and all appear in this module. In fact, your real data mining starts from this module. So I actually wanted more strength in this. Unfortunately, students are not present. So we talk about something called as association analysis. Now, association means what? Association means some connection, some relationship. We say we have a good association with that person or we have a bad association with that person. So association always means some connection which you have with a particular person. So same way here also in data mining, we are trying to find out what are the relationships we can get from the data and then analyze those relationships. That is this entire chapter about association analysis. Okay, so one second. Yeah, that is about association analysis. So now, for example, last class I had told you all, if I buy one item, I may end up buying the other item. That means that if I buy coffee powder, I may end up buying milk. So that means there is an association between coffee powder and milk. So, and then we try to analyze why the association and how it can benefit the organization. Or if I buy bread, I may end up buying milk. So again, there is an association between bread and milk. So this is what is called as association analysis. We try to establish the relationship between two or more items, and then we try to analyze how that can benefit the organization. Okay, so your third module, what we are going to cover is this is your portion. Most important thing, there are only two important things in this association analysis. One is a priori algorithm in this, how you're going to generate your frequent item sets. Frequent item sets are those items which are bought frequently. So if I go to a shopping place, maybe the chocolates are bought frequently. So you're going to find out what are the items which are bought frequently. And for that, there are two important algorithms. One is called as a priori algorithm. Another is called as FP growth algorithm. So this is what you're going to study in this particular module. How to find out the frequent items. Okay, using these two algorithms. And the third module is taken from this book, that is Introduction to Data Mining, Pang or Vipin Kumar. This book, you are getting this third module from, okay? So let us see what is this association analysis. Now, I have a set of transactions, okay? Here, I have a set of transactions. You can see here, I have put up a table over here. I'll make this a big screen. I hope everything is visible. In case any it's not visible, let me know. Now this is a set. This is a table which is present. You have a set of transactions, and these are the items. That means transaction one, the customer one comes in, he will buy bread and milk. Customer two comes in, he will buy bread, diaper, beer, and eggs. Customer three comes in, she will buy milk, diaper, beer, and coke. So these are the transactions which are happening, and what are the items we buy in each transaction. Okay, so here when these transactions are given, we should find out in association rule mining. What we do is we try to find the rules which will predict the occurrence of an item based on the occurrence of other items. Like for example, look here. In this, I hope this can be, these are the examples. If I buy diaper, I will buy beer. If I buy milk and bread, I will buy egg and coke. If I buy beer and bread, I will buy milk. So if I buy one item X, I will buy the other item Y. This is what we call as association rule mining. We are establishing the association between two or more items and generating rules based on those items. That is what we call as association rule mining. Okay. I hope this is clear. Now, the same thing, you can represent your transactions, whatever we buy. This is called as market basket data, whatever this data. Why it's called market basket is you're going into the market and you're buying transactions or items into, you're dropping them into your basket. Okay, that is why it's called as market basket transactions. So here I can represent them as a binary representation. So here you can see these are the transactions. What are the items which are there over here? All these items, whatever are there. Bread, milk, diaper, beer, eggs, coke. I've listed them over here. So in the first transaction, I have only bread and milk. So under bread and milk, I will have one and one respectively. All the others are not there in the first transaction. So all these are zero. In the second transaction, I have bread, diaper, beer, and eggs. So bread is one, diaper is one, beer is one, eggs is one. Rest of them are zero. Same way for the third transaction, you can see. Wherever items I have, whichever items I have bought, I write one against them. The other items I write zero. Okay. So this representation is what we call as a binary representation of the market basket data. Okay. So whatever I'm basketing from the market, that representation, when we represent as zeros and ones, we call it as a binary representation. So the whole objective here, I told you, is you have to find out the frequent item sets, which are the items which are bought frequently, and in turn convert them into some rules such that so that the organization can benefit from them. So there are two ways of finding these frequent item sets. One is called using the a priori algorithm, what I told you. Another one is called as FP growth algorithm. FP is frequent pattern growth algorithm. So these two algorithms are what we are going to study in this particular module. Okay, a priori algorithm and frequent FP growth algorithm. So before studying those algorithms, some terms we should know in advance. Okay, let's learn what these terms are. Now supposing I have a set of items. I'm going to represent the items as I1, I2, I3, ID. What are these items? What we saw there earlier. Bread here, bread, milk, diaper, beer, eggs, all this. These become my individual items. This is I1, bread is I1, milk is I2, diaper is I3, beer is I4, that way. Okay. So these are my set of items. Then T is a set of transactions. So here, if I go to this figure, I have, how many transactions do I have here? We have 5 transactions. T1, T2, T3, T4, and T5. So 5 transactions are there. T is a set of transactions, I is a set of items. Now, if we have a collection of one or more items, is called as an item set. So, supposing in this transaction, transaction one, if I take, you have one or more items in transaction one. Okay. If I have 2 items, it is called as a 2 item set. So, transaction one is a 2 item set. Transaction two is a, how many items you have in transaction 2? 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 items are there. So it is called as a 4 item set. Okay. Transaction 3 again is 4 item set. So the number of items in a transaction, this is called as a item set. In general, I can call an item set which contains k items is a k item set. Okay, so this is what are the first three definitions: what are items, what are transactions, and what is an item set. Is this much clear? Is it clear so far?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Now, the next definition. We have a term called as support count, which is represented by sigma. Now, support count is the frequency of occurrence of an item set. For example, see here. Here you can see, I have taken the support count of milk, bread, and diaper. So these are my, this is my market basket data on the right side what I have. Now, I want the support count of, please use a paper and your book and pen because you should write down this. Otherwise, you will not be able to do the problems which I'm giving in the next class. Okay, you should know how to calculate all this. So here I'm telling support count of milk, bread, and diaper. Now, in these transactions, you look for in how many transactions we have all the three terms, milk, bread, and diaper. So it is there in transaction 3, milk, no, it is not there. Transaction 4, bread, milk, diaper is there. Transaction 5, bread, milk, diaper is there. So two transactions contain the combination of milk, bread, and diaper. Therefore, support count of milk, bread, and diaper is equal to 2. Okay, so support count is frequency, how many times that particular item appears in the entire list of transactions. That is what we call as a support count. Okay. Next is the term support. Support is fraction of the transactions which contains the item set. So how many transactions? It is a fraction. You're going to represent as fraction. Same thing, you're going to represent it using the term S. Support count is represented using sigma. Support is represented using S. So here I'm going to take how many transactions contain this milk, bread, diaper? 2 out of totally how many transactions we have? We have 5 transactions. So support of milk, bread, and diaper is 2/5. Okay. So here I'm writing the same thing. Support of, you can see here in this box, support of X tends to Y. If there is a rule, I have a rule, say X implies Y. Support of X, this is given as X, the sigma, the support count of X union Y divided by N. One second. Okay, so it is given as support of X union Y divided by N. What happened here? Yeah. Okay, so it is given as support of support count of X union Y divided by N. Okay. Is it clear? What is support count and support?
Yes, ma'am.
Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. You please make a note of this. Support count and support as I'm teaching you all. Okay. Then next we have is frequent item sets. Now there are two terms we use over here. Okay. One is called as candidate item set and one is called as frequent item set. So I will, with an example, I will explain to you what is the difference between the two. We will leave this as it is now. Next one is association rule. Association rule means anything which is of the form X implies Y. So here I write here milk, diaper gives you beer. What does this mean? If I buy milk and diaper, I will also buy beer. Okay, so this here X is nothing but milk and diaper. Y is your beer. Okay, so this sort of representation is what we call as a association rule. Okay, the next one. Okay, next one is what is your confidence? We saw what is support. Next one, what we're going to see is what is confidence. Now, confidence is, it measures how often items imbibed appear in transactions which contain X. So, supposing I have a rule X implies Y. Okay, now I am going to check how often items in Y, that is on the right hand side, what is there, appears in transactions which contain X. So here, now look here, how you're going to measure it is confidence is nothing but, one second, let me see here, here, confidence is nothing but sigma, that is your support count of X union Y divided by support count of X. So supposing I have a rule here, this is a rule, milk diaper giving you beer. Now your X is nothing, you're checking how many times transactions in beer appear in milk and diaper. So it is wherever you should have all the three together. Support count of X union Y divided by support count of only X. See, I want to see how many times beer appears in transactions which also contain milk and diaper. Okay, so beer is my Y, milk and diaper is X. So combination of these two is what I'm going to check over here. That is what is your confidence. So here, how many transactions contain milk, diaper, beer? Milk, diaper, beer is present over here. One, milk, diaper, beer, two. Correct? So it is two upon how many transactions contain only milk and diaper? Milk and diaper is present in, say, transaction 3, 1, transaction 4, 2, transaction 5, 3. So 2 upon 3 will be your value for confidence. See here. Confidence is equal to 2 upon 3. Support count of milk, diaper, beer divided by support count of milk and diaper. Yes. Priya is right. Okay. Are you getting this? What is confidence and what is support? How do you calculate confidence and support? See, I have taken the example over here. Confidence and support. Support of milk, diaper, beer divided by transactions. What I told you there, 2 upon 5, which is 0.4. Clear so far? And these are the two parameters which are going to evaluate your rule. So your entire problems are based on the support and confidence. You have to look for rules which satisfy this much of support and some this much of confidence. I will say your support should be 40%, your confidence should be 60%. So only those rules which satisfy these two parameters, your rule should support. Okay. Are you getting it, students, what I'm teaching so far? Following or not? Any doubts with this? Okay, fine. Okay, so here, what is your association rule mining task is, as I told you, you have to look for all the transactions where, okay, you may not understand this directly now when I say these conditions, when you do the problem, you will understand this better, okay? The two conditions is, the support of that particular transaction should be greater than the minimum support. So every problem I give, I will say that minimum support should be, say, 30%, minimum confidence should be, say, 60%. So whichever rule satisfies that condition, if the rule support is greater than 30% and confidence is greater than 60%, then I will consider that particular transaction. Otherwise, I will not consider the transaction at all. Okay, so only those transactions become my frequent patterns, which satisfy the minimum support and minimum confidence. Okay. So in frequent item set regeneration, we have two main rules. We will come to this brute force approach later when I'm dealing with that. Okay. Now, these are just some examples of rules. You can see over here, milk, the first rule is milk diaper gives you beer. Can you just try if you're getting these values? If I take this rule, I have got support as 0.4 and confidence is 0.67. In some of them, I have intentionally put errors. Can you just, I understand, tell me which are the ones which have errors? Or if all are correct, you calculate the support and confidence of each of these rules. this table is given to you, okay, and this is the rule which is given. Take the first rule, milk diaper giving you beer. Calculate what is the support and what is the confidence of that rule using that formula. Can you do it quickly for all the rules and check if the data which I've given is right or wrong? Are you all doing? Is the first one correct or wrong, what I've given?
Correct, ma'am.
First one is correct, ma'am.
Yes, it should not take so much time. Is the first one correct or wrong? Sushma, first one's wrong. Vijayalakshmi says first one's wrong. What is the support and what is the confidence you're getting?
First one is correct, ma'am.
And second is also correct.
Support is 0.6, okay. Confidence?
Point four.
Sushma is not there.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so what is the confidence? Sushma, why it's taking so much time? 2 minutes, just a division you have to do, no? Two numbers. Confidence is 0.6. So here 6, 7, is it right or? Okay, so support is 0.4 and confidence is 0.6. That means his answer is correct then. Then just check, Vijayalakshmi, just check them. See, what is the support? Support is equal to count of X union Y divided by N. N is nothing but 5. So how many you get over here? The total number of transactions is 5. And X union Y means milk, diaper and beer, all three together. So milk, diaper, beer is there where in the transaction 3, in transaction 4, in transaction 5. So 3 by 5. 3 by 5, do you get it as 0.4? Three by five is 0.6. No, then how did you get 0.4, Sushma? Isn't it 3 by 5?
Ma'am, it's 2 by 5. It's 2 by 5, ma'am.
Yeah, how did Sushma get 0.4? 2 by 5. See, it is, what is the rule which says? The rule is X union Y. X union Y means X is milk and diaper, Y is beer. So milk, diaper, beer is present in milk, diaper, beer in transaction 3. Milk, diaper, beer, transaction 4. Okay, okay, only two transactions. Okay, okay, fine. So 2 by 5. Fine, it is correct. 0.6, 0.4 and 0.67. So the first, I think I've understood now how you're going to calculate the support and confidence. Okay, you can just frame any type of rules and check the support and confidence. Okay, so all these are the different, just an example of different types of rules. Is it clear now, all of you, how to support, how to calculate support and confidence? Clear? Clear or not? Okay, fine. So now, okay, now I told you there are two ways of mining association rules. One is using this frequent item set generation. That is what Lisa said. The support should be greater than the minimum support. And the second one is using some rule generation. We will see what this is. Now in your frequent item set generation, this figure is what I call as an item set lattice. I have different rules over here. I mean, different items over here. You can see A, B, C, D, E. These are my different items. Okay. Now I can form, you know, the combination of these items like how we did in the first module. So if I have D possible items, all the different combination of items, these are called as the candidate items. So I told you there is a difference between candidate item and frequent item. Candidate item means all the different possible combination of items is what we call as a candidate item. Whereas those items which satisfy a particular threshold, those items are called as frequent items. Okay. Now in this figure, I have drawn all the possible candidate items are being drawn over here. You can see that, right? Okay. Now, this representation is what we call as an item set lattice. So what we do over here in your a priori algorithm, what it says is, if an item set is frequent, then all its subsets must also be frequent. See, earlier I told you, if we want to reduce the, you know, the best way to generate frequent item sets is here. Either you have to reduce the number of candidates, candidate means the items which are there, or reduce the number of transactions, or reduce the number of comparisons. These are three ways in which we can generate the frequent item sets, reducing the computational complexity, whatever is there. So how do we reduce the number of transactions or the comparisons? Certain assumptions we have to make. These are proven assumptions. According to a priori principle, if an item set is frequent, now see here, assume that here CDE is a frequent item set, then all its subsets must also be frequent. That means CDE is giving rise to which subset? CD, CE. Again, CD is giving rise to C and D. CE is giving rise to C and E. DE is giving rise to D and E. Again, these three go to null. So if this is frequent, then I can by default assume that all its subsets are frequent. So once I get this item as a frequent item set, I don't have to check for the remaining items. What happens there, I'm going to reduce the time taken for comparisons and the number of transactions also get reduced. Okay, so on this assumption, your a priori principle works. If an item set is frequent, all its subsets must also be frequent. Same way, the converse of it, if an item set is infrequent, it's not CDE, it is AB. Okay, I've written it wrong. If an item set is infrequent, then all its supersets, it is not subset, all its supersets should also be infrequent. Just change this. System is a bit slow. Yeah, here, if what I have to write here, if AB is infrequent, then all its supersets are also infrequent. Okay, that is what you want to try and say over here. So if I find that one particular item AB is infrequent, I don't have to check for the remaining supersets. All these will be infrequent. Then what I do with the infrequent item sets, I will prune them. Pruning means I'm going to cut off them. I'm not going to consider them for my frequent item sets anymore. Okay, so there I'm going to reduce the number of transactions again. Pruning is a new word over here. Pruning means cutting off that particular branch of the tree. So this structure is what we call as an item set lattice. What are the two assumptions we make in a priori principle? First assumption is, if an item set is frequent, then all its subsets must be frequent. So I don't have to again do comparison. Now, if CDE, I find it as a frequent one, then all its subsets, CD, CE, all these are frequent. Then I don't have to again check the support and confidence for each of these. It is by default frequent, okay? Same way, if an item set is infrequent, then all its supersets are also infrequent. Okay, so if AB is infrequent, then all these, its superset is A, whatever supersets are there, they also become infrequent. And once they are infrequent, what you have to do? Then they have to be pruned. Pruned means cut off. And this concept is what we call as support-based pruning. So based on the support of this, I'm going to prune them. I find that the support is less, then I'm going to prune all the other supersets. Okay. And this property is what we call as monotonicity property. See here. Monotonicity, anti-monotone property. This is called as anti-monotone property. So what does the a priori principle say? If an item set is frequent, all its subsets must also be frequent. So here, when I say frequency, how do I measure it? Using the support measure. We have learned support and confidence. So using support measure, I'm going to decide whether a particular item set is frequent or not. So that means if I have a function X, which is a subset of Y, then support of X should be less than support of Y. Okay. And this property is what we call as a anti-monotone property. Okay. So based on this, we are going to define our a priori principle. Okay. So is this much clear? You'll understand the a priori principle more when I do problems on them. Okay. Now, since the time is running out, I will start another session for another 10-15 minutes. So I'll just exit this session and you people log into the other session. Okay.